Trigeminal neuralgia is a debilitating facial pain. With us today is Dr. Ronald Warnick, a neurosurgeon with Mayfield Brain and Spine, to share his expertise.
What I'm going to do is talk first about a patient, just to show you a typical example of what I call the full circle of care. And then I'm going to discuss a few general concepts about trigeminal nerve and trigeminal neuralgia. Then talk about taking a history and examining a patient. I was helped by our former nurse practitioner at Jewish Hospital, Amy, and she helped me put the fine point on what you would like to hear. And she said, I bet everybody would like to know how to take a history, what to look for in examination, and also what are the scoring systems. Then I'm going to talk about diagnostic workup, medical therapy, which you may start on some patients, and then surgical therapy options, which is what I do and what my partners do, and then the implications for your practice, either as a nurse practitioner, PA, or other. So the case study, 31-year-old woman with two types of pain involving the right upper teeth and jaw. Very important was she pointed right at her teeth. The first pain, which you'll later learn to be type 1 pain, was stabbing, ice pick, and it was intermittent. It came in episodes. The second pain, though, was dull, aching, constant, and that's what we call type 2. Now, this patient went to see a dentist first and then went on to have extraction of wisdom teeth by an oral surgeon, thought that was the problem, but no improvement, was referred to an endodontist who suspected trigeminal neuralgia, referred the patient to a neurologist who confirmed the diagnosis of both type 1 and type 2 trigeminal neuralgia, and started the patient on Tegretol with initial good relief of pain, at least the type 1 pain. Ultimately, she was referred to me because the pain was intractable, despite the fact that she had had 4 different medications, not necessarily at once, but just tried over time. And she underwent gamma knife radiosurgery with complete relief of type 1 pain, improvement in type 2 pain, the dull aching pain. But then that type 2 pain became worse and worse. And I got fooled. I started increasing the gabapentin thinking it was type 2 trigeminal neuralgia. But then she told me she could not chew on that side. And I said, I wonder if there's some dental pathology going on. Had her go back to the dentist, referred her to an oral surgeon, who then found an affected second molar. It was removed and she had dramatic decrease in her pain, and I was able to reduce her gabapentin. So this is an example of somebody who had both trigeminal neuralgia and dental pathology, very hard to figure out. And that's why every patient with oral facial pain requires input from multiple disciplines, whether they're neurology, neurosurgery, the primary care physician or the APC, and all of the dental professionals, and maybe even ENT. Multidisciplinary. I think all of you know that trigeminal nerve supplies sensation to the face. If you look at the diagram on the right, V1 is the forehead and upper lid. V2 is the cheek and the upper lip. And V3 is the jaw and the lower lip. And of course, there's a corresponding area inside the mouth. The lower teeth and jaw are V3, and the upper teeth and jaw are V2. Now, V3 also has a motor component. So for biting and chewing, it's important for that also. Now, in this diagram, if you notice, these 3 divisions come together in this ganglion or control center. And there's this beautiful diagram on the left, or not diagram, but a picture from an anatomic dissection, where you can see V1 coming into this ganglion, V2 through the foramen rotundum, little opening there, and very important opening, the foramen ovale, V3. And you'll see why this particular opening is very important later for one of the procedures we do. But they all coalesce here, and you see how it's kind of like a lattice work. And then it comes together as the nerve, the root entry nerve, it goes into the brainstem. So this is the anatomy, three branches coming to the ganglion and then going back into the nerve root that goes into the brainstem, and then signals go up to the brain. Okay. Who's affected by this? Well, if you look at the graph on the right, it's mainly people in middle age. The peak is 50 to 60 years old. But I see people as late in age in their 90s. About 5 patients per 100,000 are diagnosed each year in the United States. More common in women than men by far, and no other factors that we can determine. Here are those definitions. This is key to the rest of the talk and to evaluating patients in office. Type 1 pain, also called classic or classical, typical. This is 75% of patients. It is sharp, shooting, stabbing, zapping, electric. These are the kinds of things, like a zap, they'll say. It occurs in episodes or events, and these events last for seconds to minutes, not usually hours. There are many triggers. Look at all the different things that can trigger this. Each patient has their own set of triggers. Very important is that there's a refractory period after an attack, such that triggers don't affect anymore, don't trigger. So if somebody has an attack, they should not have another attack by just touching the same location. There's a refractory period. So if somebody says, yes, every time I touch here, I have one. And if I keep touching, I keep having them. You have to be suspicious because there are several minutes to an hour period where you cannot elicit the same attack by virtue of a trigger. Now, type 2 pain is very elusive. It's in about 10% of patients. In my practice, maybe 20%. It is dull, aching, throbbing, burning, vice-like. Every description other than under type 1. And they tend to be more constant. In fact, the definition for type 2 is it must occur for greater than 50% of your waking hours. There are typically no triggers, and this is definitely less responsive to medication and to procedures. So if you have a patient that has, and about 30% of patients will have both type 1 and type 2, and you give them medication, the type 1 will respond faster and better than the type 2. You might have to wait longer to have relief of the type 2. Then there's secondary trigeminal neuralgia. This is where a tumor or multiple sclerosis is producing the trigeminal neuralgia, and that's approximately 15% of patients with trigeminal neuralgia. I'll show you a couple of examples of that later. The pain distribution, it's more likely to be on the right than the left in the 60-40% ratio. We don't know why. And the lower face, V2-3, is 70% of all of the distributions. So V1 is only 30%. We don't know why that is either. If somebody has type 1 and type 2 pain, they could be in different distributions altogether. You could have type 1 pain in the V1 distribution, but the type 2 could be in V2-3. So they don't necessarily coincide. Trigeminal neuralgia never crosses midline. So if a patient says to you, well, I have pain that goes all the way across my forehead or cheek or jaw, I don't think that's trigeminal neuralgia. Sure, a patient can have bilateral trigeminal neuralgia, and that's a terrible thing. That's about 5% of the time. But they are not going to have it at the same time. They're going to have an attack on one side, then maybe it'd be a couple of days later, attack on the other side. Okay, how do you take a history? I kind of break it up into two parts, more general questions about their history, and then what about the episodes of pain? I will ask, or my medical assistant, who's very experienced, Michelle, will ask the date of the first attack. Was there a precipitant, such as a dental procedure? What is the quality of the pain? That's getting at, you know, is it type 1 or type 2? And triggers and medications. What are you currently on? And what were you on? Did it work? Did you stop it because it didn't work, or did you stop it because you had side effects? We need to know all of that. Because if this drug that they're currently on doesn't work, I need to know what the next drug will be. Now, the episodes of pain, how frequent are they? How long do they last typically? And what is the visual analog scale score associated with that? And we use that pain scale. We show this to them because, you know, lots of people say it's a 10, but 10 means you want to go to the emergency room. That's how bad it is. So this questionnaire done by Dr. Burchell, who's a neurosurgeon who specialized in functional neurosurgery and trigeminal neuralgia, he's at Oregon State University. And this link, and by the way, this talk will be online ultimately, but this link will take you to a questionnaire, 21 questions that the patient can answer, and it'll help you in several ways. First of all, is it trigeminal neuralgia? It should answer that question for you. Next question, is it type 1 or type 2? You may have an idea, but maybe you'd like some confirmation by this questionnaire. And lastly, is the pain caused by trauma or another condition? So was there some trauma, car accident, dental procedure, patient have herpes, is this postherpetic neuralgia? It comes out with an answer. And for me, I'm hoping the answer is TN1 or trigeminal neuralgia type 1, because that's what's most easiest treated with medication and with procedures. What about when examining the patient? I have here the what I call the autonomous zones. These are the areas that if you were to touch them, they're almost all the contribution is by that particular branch. Because you can imagine these dermatomes or these distributions, they overlap somewhat. So where could you test on the face that could only be that distribution? Well, here it is, V1. Right above the eyebrow, just at the pupillary line. V2, over the malar eminence. Very safe, you know it's V2. And V3, just below the lower lip. If you test these areas, you will know whether there's any loss of sensation in V1, V2, V3, without any concern about overlap. So the way I do it, is I test the light touch, not pinprick, but light touch in all three divisions. And this is an example here, but I will tell you that I do it simultaneously. So I take two Q-tips, I touch right above the eyebrows, malar eminence, and then right below the lower lip. And I try to elicit a difference between the two sides. Then I take that Q-tip and I kind of pull the cotton out a bit to form a wisp. And I touch the cornea and I look for the corneal reflex. And I want to see that they're symmetrical. So I've done the history. I've done the quiz, the examination. Now I need to score the patient. And there are two standard scales. One is the Barrow Neurologic Institute Pain Scale. And this goes from Roman numeral 1 through 5. And an important definition, the levels 1, 2, and 3A are considered pain-free. Now, I understand that 3A is pain-free with medication, but for all the studies, this is what we consider pain-free, these three levels, and everything else is a pain, persistent pain. Then there's also the Barrow scale for hypesthesia, that is facial numbness, 1 being no numbness, and then everything else being some numbness, all the way up to very bothersome numbness. Here is the integrated office note. I want to show you my typical note. A 36-year-old woman with a 9-month history of left V1 through 3, all three divisions, trigeminal neuralgia. The pain is electric and zapping. You know that it's type 1. There are triggers, typical. Patient on 2 medications, both gabapentin and tegretol. Very poor control of pain. You can see this, 10 to 20 a day. And here's the quiz, TN1. That's a relief. Barrel 4, really terrible pain. Visual analog score of 7 and no facial numbness. By the way, about 30% of patients who present with trigeminal neuralgia will have some subjective complaint of numbness, although not very commonly seen on examination. I've listed the medications clearly here, and I've listed the exam findings. So that's your typical trigeminal office note from me. The diagnostic workup. All patients with trigeminal neuralgia need an MRI. We need to rule out a tumor, rule out a vascular malformation. We also need to assess the degree of vascular compression. You know, is there an artery compressing the nerve that's the cause of the pain? I've listed here exactly how to order the scan in Epic. This should be helpful to you if you ever want to order one, because you don't want to waste an MRI. I mean, when I say waste, order an MRI, and then the specialist says, oh, I need to get trigeminal views. No, go right to the trigeminal MRI. You can do it. I asked our MRI tech, lead tech, how would you order it based on what I do? And she said, I'd order this, MRI of the brain with and without contrast to include MP Rage, which may not be understandable yet, but that's a 3D scan, 1 millimeter cuts, and that's with contrast, and that's the entire brain. Then next is the CIS, sometimes called the KISS. This is a different view of the trigeminal nerve. It's also 3D, it's also 1 millimeter, but we don't do the whole brain. We do just through the trigeminal nerves, and we do both axial across the head and coronal, looking at the patient straight ahead. And then we also do an MRA, the MR angiography, looking for compressive blood vessels. So you can order that. And this is what we see. This is the MP Rage, beautiful anatomy. This is the trigeminal nerve right here, this gray stripe. And just above the pointer is a small vessel that may or may not be compressive in this patient. This is the CIS. We see the nerve even better, although we don't see the vessel. And this is the MRA, not as high resolution, and we do not see the vessel at all, which means it's a vein, because this is the MRA. It's good for arteries. Look at the carotid arteries. It's not good for veins. That would be an MRV. But we're mainly interested in arteries, so we order an MRA. Patients ask me, what is the cause of my trigeminal neuralgia? And in 70% of patients, it will be compression of the nerve by an artery. I don't know if you can see this gray nerve, this stripe. Your probably eye is drawn to this white line, which is an artery, the superior cerebellar artery, which is compressing the nerve, which is the cause of the pain. And luckily, we can grade these so that we know that if the artery here in this diagram is just near the blood, the trigeminal nerve, no problem. If on the right-hand side here, it is just touching the nerve, also not an issue. But if it's compressing the nerve or distorting the nerve, moving it out of position, then the artery is likely the cause of the trigeminal neuralgia. But what about the patients, the 30% of patients who do not have an artery compressing the vein, the nerve? What about those patients? I think it, and we have evidence to believe that it's a short circuit within the nerve. In other words, there's demyelination of the nerve fibers. So they've lost some of their myelin, and there's crosstalk or short circuit between the nerve fibers. So when the patient, let's say, touches their face or wind blows against their face, it sends a signal down the nerve, and that signal is amplified by virtue of there being short circuit or crosstalk between nerve fibers, and that sends a gigantic signal to the brain, which comes out as excruciating pain. So if you don't have a vessel, we think it's a short circuit situation. I promised you that I'd show you cases of secondary trigeminal neuralgia. on the left is a benign tumor. The arrow here is pointing to the trigeminal nerve. And here is the meningioma compressing and deviating the nerve. All you have to do is remove the meningioma. It gets rid of the meningioma and takes care of the pain. Immediate relief. Here's on the right, a much tougher situation. This is a patient with multiple sclerosis who unfortunately also has a plaque in the brainstem, in the pons, right at the point where the trigeminal nerve comes into the brainstem, and they have multiple sclerosis on that basis. And that's a very difficult type of multiple sclerosis to solve, to cure. Medical therapy, critical, because if you see a patient with trigeminal neuralgia, you refer them to, let's say, neurologist or neurosurgeon, they may not get an immediate appointment. And it's incumbent upon you to start a drug. And the most common drug is Tegretol. But what I'm showing here are the different classes of drugs. Tegretol is in class of sodium channel blockers. Gabapentin is in calcium channel blockers. And then these two drugs that you don't see used very much anymore, baclofen and Depakote, are GABA, the neurotransmitter GABA agonists. It's weird because if you look at gabapentin and pregabalin, they have GABA in the name. Wouldn't that mean they relate to GABA, the neurotransmitter? Well, that's what they thought, but it turns out, you know, when they name them, but it turns out they're merely calcium channel blockers. But all of these drugs, no matter what class, they reduce the nerve excitability and they slow the conduction of signals along the fibers. And by that, you also know the side effects because it will depress the brain in terms of function.
Is there a specific target dose? Oh, never mind.
Aha, yes. I would be remiss if I didn't mention that. So how long has Tegretol been around? 1962, but not for trigeminal neuralgia. It was started for a seizure medication. All these are seizure medications. You may have patients with seizures who are on these. And I mentioned the first line of treatment is Tegretol because it's both therapeutic and diagnostic. By that, I mean, you can help the patient reduce their pain, control their pain. They may get relief within days. But also, if they don't get relief, you should be questioning the diagnosis of trigeminal neuralgia type 1 because 90% of patients with TN1, type 1, will respond to Tegretol. In fact, Dr. Birchall's questionnaire has that as a question. And if you answered you were given Tegretol and it didn't work, it takes away several points from the possibility that you have trigeminal neuralgia type 1. Of course, with any of these drugs, they may not be long-lasting, and that's part of their problem. Okay, to answer your question, I start out at 100 milligrams twice a day for a week. And if somebody is older, 80 or older, I might give them 2 weeks on that before going up. The second week, I'll go to 200 milligrams twice a day. And I will keep ramping it up every week until one of two things happen: pain relief or dose-limiting side effects. And I'll do that until the patient reaches 1,200 milligrams a day, total dose. Now, older patients are not going to tolerate 1,200. I mean, they might have trouble at 800. So it's individual. If you start Tegretol, you must get blood tests roughly a month later because of the risk of hyponatremia. So I order a renal, CBC, liver enzymes. But the most important is ruling out hyponatremia. Some of these patients can drop into, low 120s sodium, and then you have to consider changing from Tegretol to another drug. You do not need to monitor the blood level. That's not indicated. By the way, patients ask me, I was on the Tegretol, but I was given the generic, and we don't think there's any difference between them. Both are good. But what happens with breakthrough pain? How do you manage that? You're ramping up the Tegretol. You're not getting the effect you want. Well, you should maximize that first drug before adding a second drug. And when you add the second drug, it should be of a different class. So if you have Tegretol, a sodium channel blocker, the next drug should be gabapentin, for example, a calcium channel blocker, trying to get different effects. Then you gradually increase the second drug. Try to avoid overreacting. You know, like in my office, a patient will say, well, I need more. Can I increase? Can I increase? I say, no, wait a few more days, because you don't want to chase your tail. And you don't want to end up with the patient toxic and falling. And I'm sure you do this in your practice. Never change two drugs or two drug dosages at one time. Because if you do, and there's a problem, how will you know which it was? Only change one thing at a time, even if the patient asks. Today, a patient asked me, I'd like to taper off my medications. Okay, we'll start tapering your gabapentin now that you've had treatment, gamma knife. Well, I'd like to taper both, and absolutely not, just one at a time, then a break of a week or two, kind of a washout, and then the next one. And if the patient is on two or any one, two, or three drugs, and believe me, some patients are on four drugs, and there's a problem, a toxicity, particularly imbalance and falls, and you need to, that's when you need to check the levels of any drug whose level you can check. Now, there is a syndrome which I see very rarely, and luckily, it's a trigeminal neuralgia crisis. And these patients show up in the emergency room, and this patient I'm going to show here showed up in my office for a consult. I mean, she comes in, and she looks sick to me. And she's holding her jaw and she can't talk. Her husband is talking for her. She's 51 and just recently came, trigeminal neuralgia started. She's having over 100 episodes a day, lasting minutes, 10 out of 10. When I say go to the emergency room, you're right, because I sent her to the emergency room. She had had no relief with medication and she had not eaten or had any fluids over 4 days. She was severely dehydrated, orthostatic hypotension. So we took her to the emergency room. They gave her IV fluids and then Keppra, 1,000 milligrams IV over 15 minutes. And she had dramatic relief. We basically broke the cycle of the pain that allowed us some time. We increased the gabapentin and that gave us the time we needed to, you know, to start increasing the medication. So this happens rarely. But I occasionally will have the crisis, and we have it set up at Jewish where the patients go to basically the infusion center, which is mainly oncology, but they can go there. We can have an order, have a standing order, and give them 1,000 of Keppra. And you can also give other drugs, fosphenytoin, Vimpat, but we like Keppra. And, you know, they all have CNS side effects. So they're cognitive, imbalanced, disequilibrium, falls. You have to watch for these, especially in the elderly. You don't want somebody to fall based on, you know, your toxicity of the medication and then break a hip. And then rash. But this is a special thing I need to discuss. Everyone here is familiar with Stevens-Johnson. You never want to have a patient with this. I agree. But this can happen with many of these drugs, including Tegretol. And it turns out that there is a way of detecting whether somebody has a high risk of Stevens-Johnson. It's by looking at the HLA B1502 allele. And this marker is mainly seen in Asian populations, and it's predictive of Stevens-Johnson. So there's a black box warning by the FDA that any Asian patient for whom you're starting any of these drugs, Tegretol, Trileptal, Lamictal, Dilantin, you must get this test. And if it's positive, you cannot start these medications. Now, the problem is this test doesn't come back immediately. So it's difficult. Sometimes you have to start the patient in hospital, maybe ready for a rash. Okay, you've done all the medication and you know, you follow the patient, and they seem to be failing, they're miserable. I think that's the time to refer the patient that they've tried at least two different medications. And that's the threshold for my practice. They must have tried at least two medications, not necessarily at the same time, but but they could have been sequential and failed. Or they have dose-limiting side effects, usually cognitive, can't work, can't take care of their family, or contribute to their family, or both. Or finally, the patient just says, you know, I just don't feel right. I don't feel toxic. I don't feel terrible, but I just don't feel right. I don't want to go my whole life like this. And then, of course, patients with drug interactions, there are some antidepressants that are not, they make Tegretol contraindicated, and then the allele. So there are two main categories of surgical treatment options. The first is non-destructive, where there's no injury to the nerve. And that's the microvascular decompression. That's where we're, that's also called MVD, and I'll show that in a minute. And then the other two are destructive to different degrees. The percutaneous, this PSR is the needle procedure, and this is highly destructive to the nerve. And then radiosurgery is slightly destructive to the nerve. So let's start with microvascular decompression. This has been part of our history for quite a while, since 1967, when it was refined by Dr. Janetta, the University of Pittsburgh. It is the procedure of choice, particularly for a younger patient who has vascular compression on the MRI. It's good for all distributions of pain. It doesn't matter, V1, V2, V3, all, it can handle anything. But it's generally reserved for patients less than 70 who don't have a lot of medical problems because it requires general anesthesia. And the great thing about this, it provides immediate relief of pain. The patients wake up from the anesthesia in the recovery room and they have no pain whatsoever in most cases. So this is a patient who underwent microvascular decompression. I'm going to show you the operation. 34-year-old with right-sided trigeminal neuralgia, definitely type 1, many attacks a day. Your classic example of initial relief with Tegretol, but then failed, then had to go to gabapentin, and then having terrible side effects for a young person, which is lethargic, unable to work. And the MRI shows vascular compression. So remember, the MRI, this is the right side, and this is the trigeminal nerve. And just to the, you can just see there, there's one vessel right there, and another vessel, which is more significant right here. So double vessel compression. So an MVD was recommended. And this is a beautiful illustration by Tanya Hines, who's in the audience, showing the surgical exposure. The patient is under general anesthesia, lying supine with their head turned to roll under their shoulder. You can see the incision that's made, the opening in the bone. And this is what it looks like under the microscope. The trigeminal nerve is yellow. This is the cerebellum, gently retracted. This is the brainstem. And here is the loop of the artery. It was compressing the trigeminal nerve. And then this one had a bonus in that it also had a vein, the superior petrosal vein, which is crossing over the nerve and also providing some or causing some compression. And so what the surgeon did is separate, and you have to see these strands here. You have to dissect all this out and separate those strands to allow the artery to be moved away from the nerve, and then the sponge is put in place. Now the vein, you can sacrifice, so it does not need a sponge. Okay, I thought it would be nice for you to see a live video of the operation. This is under the microscope. What you see here that has the striations on it is the trigeminal nerve, the kind of off white. And here are the two arteries. And in this case, the surgeon is dissecting those arteries, separating them from the trigeminal nerve itself, because he's going to need to put a sponge underneath the trigeminal nerve interposed to keep those arteries from compressing the nerve. And here he is putting the sponge in place. And you see, when you put the sponge in, you can't see anything at first. So some of this is based on tactile, you know, the feel of being able to, the pathway of least resistance, which is under the nerve. Okay, this patient woke up in the recovery room with complete relief of pain, no facial numbness, usually there is none, and was gradually tapered off with Tegretol and the gabapentin, and it remains pain-free 5 years after surgery and will likely remain pain-free for the rest of life. Now, this has the longest name, percutaneous stereotactic rhizotomy. This is a different procedure. I like to call this the needle procedure, but or it also has the abbreviation PSR. This was developed at Mass General by Dr. Sweet in 1967. And Dr. Tu, who worked with Dr. Sweet, came to Cincinnati and introduced and refined the procedure here at the University of Cincinnati. This is only for trigeminal neuralgia of V2 and V3. It cannot be used for V1 because this procedure causes numbness. And so you can't do it for V1 because if you did, you would have numbness over the cornea and that would be a terrible outcome. Now, this procedure can be done for a patient of any age, any medical condition, regardless of their MRI findings. It does provide immediate relief of pain. So it's a very good procedure if somebody comes into the emergency room with trigeminal crisis, especially an older person or somebody with no vessel. You can take them even that day or certainly the next day to the suite and do the PSR. Unfortunately, in order for this to work, the patient will have facial numbness. If a patient wakes up without facial numbness, they're not going to have pain relief. So this is both, that's how you tell if the procedure has worked, is the face numb? But of course, that's not great for the patient either. So this is an 85-year-old woman who underwent the case. This is my case study of this, who a 10-year history of pain. She had left V2. And it was type 1, and she was on multiple medications. And this is an example of an elderly patient on multiple medications. She's falling, three falls over a 1 month period of time. She's too elderly to undergo the MVD procedure. I don't know if she even had a vessel, but it wouldn't matter. 85 is really too high in age to undergo general anesthesia and the MVD procedure. So this diagram on the right, also by Tanya, shows the needle going through the cheek up into the Gasserian ganglion or the trigeminal ganglion or the control center. And that's where we're going to do a lesion or destruction of several nerve fibers in order to lead to pain relief. The left hand over here is basically a schematic of how we use landmarks and palpation to insert the needle through that foramen ovale. Remember the V3 that I showed you, which allows access to that ganglion, the trigeminal ganglion. And it's done under fluoroscopy. And here is the needle with the verification that the tip is in the appropriate location. And here's a diagram showing what we plan to do. The needle is placed at a certain depth and the curved electrode is either curved up for V2 or down for V3. And although the schematic shows an example of V1, it would rarely be done for that. That'd be a pretty desperate situation, again, because of corneal abrasion or ultimate. Now, this is not the 85-year-old patient. I think you know that. This is the patient, a different patient, where we have a video and Dr. Tu has inserted the electrode and now he's going to check the position on the fluoroscopy. So he's asking Nancy, his nurse, to duck, and here it is. And you can see the curve of the electrode that's in the correct location. And you see the patient's awake right now, and I didn't tell you, but it's done under twilight anesthesia. But at this point, they're going to wake the patient up a bit or allow her to wake up because he's going to go do a test stimulus, test shock to see if her pain is in the correct location. Is the electrode in the right location? And this is going to be a little hard to see. You see how she winces, and he's going to give another one, and she's going to wince. And he's going to check to make sure that it's in the left V2 distribution by touching her face because he doesn't want to lesion doesn't want to destroy nerve fibers unless he can confirm that it's in V2. And she says, is it in this region? She says, yes. Or is it in V3? She says, no. So then he's going to put the patient deeper asleep. And if you look at the right-hand image, you'll see he's going to do a lesion of V2 by this current, which heats the fibers and destroys them. So it's an iterative process where insertion, test, lesion, then he's going to allow the patient to wake up a bit, test the cheek with a pin to make sure that area is numb. And if it's not numb, he's going to go do it all over again. And he's going to keep doing until there's a patch of numbness that corresponds to the majority of V2 distribution so that he knows the patient will wake up pain-free. So it's a difficult procedure for everyone. Now, this patient didn't wake up, the 85-year-old didn't wake up pain-free, but rather was pain-free the next day. She had somewhat bothersome numbness, grade 3 numbness, but at 1 month was pain-free and had a stable degree of numbness, and then was gradually tapered off of medication. Later, at 1 year, she was pain-free, remained pain-free, and the numbness was a little bit less. It was no longer bothersome. So you see, there is some decrement in the numbness over time, and that's a good thing. Okay, Gamma Knife. And this is the procedure that I do. Gamma Knife was developed at the Karolinska Institute in Stockholm, Sweden in 1953, Dr. Lexell. And the entire equipment is named after Dr. Lexell. It's for all distributions of pain, any age, any medical condition, again, regardless of MRI finding. That's similar to the PSR, only it's any distribution, V1, V2, V3. One downside of Gamma Knife is it's delayed. 50% of patients will respond within 1 month and 50% between 1 month and 3 months. So it's not good for the patient who has very, very, like a crisis pain, because it takes too long to work for that patient. It's more for patients who are beginning to fail medication. Intervene early with Gamma Knife and you can get the result that you want. Facial numbness is less common than for the PSR. PSR is 100% and this is 20%. So this is a patient who I treated, 62-year-old with a 4-year history of pain in the left V2 distribution. He was a barber in Northern Kentucky. He was having a difficult time because he would have these triggers whenever he talked, the pain would come on, and who talks more than barber? Hairstylist, they interact. He was on 2 different medications with inadequate pain control. If you look at the MRI on the left-hand side, the trigeminal nerve, there was a small vessel there, a large vessel there, but they were not compressive. He was deemed not a candidate for microvascular decompression. He was the right age, but just didn't have compressive vessels. So we did the Gamma Knife. Now the concept of Gamma Knife is, we have 192 beams of radiation that intersect on a point, the point being the trigeminal nerve just before it comes into the brainstem. We place the frame under twilight anesthesia, conscious sedation. I numb up 2 areas in front and 2 areas in back, and these pins that go through the skin into the outer layer of the bone. And this provides a solid foundation for both the scan and the actual delivery of the radiation. It stays on all day. And it starts at 6 a.m. and the patient gets out about 1 or 2 p.m. So here he is. This is the barber, and he's happy in the frame. And then after the imaging, I take the MRI and the CAT scan, I put them together. And here is the trigeminal nerve on the left side. And you'll see a green outline, but I'll just put the laser pointer right there. I think that's appropriate. That's where we're going to aim the 192 beams of radiation. And we do that in a way that we avoid dose to the brainstem and we avoid dose to the temporal lobe. So we hit this at a very high dose, but the Gamma Knife has very rapid fall off of radiation. So the rest of the brain is getting very low dose. Here's the patient now connected to the table so they cannot move their head. They move into the gamma knife. You can see what it looks like. Here's a cutaway of this cone of the gamma knife. 100, each one of those black dots represents one of the 192 beams of radiation that are going to then intersect on the trigeminal nerve. This treatment takes 30 to 60 minutes, painless. They listen to music. They don't really hear anything else, just the music. They come out. We take off the frame, keep them on the medication, and let them go home. Now, this patient had very early response. I think even that night he said he felt better. That's rare. But at 2 weeks, everything was better. Frequency less, duration less, VAS much less. At 1 month, he was pain-free. We started tapering the medications. At 3 months, he was pain-free without medications. So now he's Barrow grade one, and he has no numbness. So he's facial numbness score of one. So he's 1-1, the best you can be. And he's done well. Now, I put together just a little chart to summarize. I'm not going to go over every little thing, but just some highlights. How would I compare these procedures? Well, the MVD, the open operation, is best for young patients who are in good medical condition, where there has to be a vessel that's compressive or distorts the nerve. It's inpatient and it's general anesthesia. So you got to take that into account, and it's immediate. The PSR, the biggest downside is, or one big downside, is that it's V2-3 only. V1, very rarely. So if somebody has V1, I don't even discuss PSR with them. It's not possible. The biggest downside, though, is definitely the new facial numbness. You have to have facial numbness to have a benefit. And so we tend not to start, you know, we try for MVD in any patient. We tend to keep the PSR in our back pocket till the end. And so the second procedure of choice is really the radiosurgery. Stereotactic radiosurgery, that's the SRS. Unfortunately, it doesn't have immediate pain relief, but the risk of numbness is much lower. So if I were to have trigeminal neuralgia and there were a vessel associated, you know, compressive on my MRI, I would definitely have an MVD. If there was not, I would definitely have gamma knife. If that didn't work, I would have the needle procedure, the PSR. Now, it's very important to intervene early with surgical procedures because two important studies were done, one on MVD showing that patients who were treated with MVD within 5 years of their diagnosis did better overall compared to ones that were greater than 5 years. And you know that's true for other things too. The longer you treat somebody with medical therapy, the less likely they're going to respond to surgical therapy. With gamma knife, the inflection point was 4 years. That's the paper that Laura mentioned. Patients less than 4 years, treated less than 4 years, did significantly better. So you don't want to treat too soon, but you don't want them hanging out on medication for 4, 5, 10 years. I'd like to complete this talk by talking about implications for your practice. I mean, a lot of this applies to your practice, I hope. I know you may not see a lot of these patients, but when you do, I hope you have this talk as a reference. Maybe you can go to the website, take some screenshots of the critical slides, and utilize that in your practice. So multidisciplinary care. You may need to utilize many of the subspecialists, and we may need you. But first, what are some dental considerations? Because sometimes it's confusing because trigeminal neuralgia affects the teeth, gums, jaw, and can masquerade as dental disease. And many of the triggers relate to the mouth, chewing, brushing, and that's the same for dental pain. And as you saw with the first case I presented, you can have both trigeminal neuralgia and dental disease. They can intermix. How do you figure this out? Well, I would consider referring the patient to a dental professional, starting maybe with their dentist, if they've had prior dental work in the same area as the pain. So if you listed in your history that was an area where they had a root canal or an extraction, then maybe they should go to the endodontist for the root canal. and have it checked out, or the oral surgeon for the extraction. And if the pain is localized to a specific tooth, then that is something that maybe referring to the dental professional makes sense, because sometimes they'll tell me, it's just in this tooth. And I go, well, that could be trigeminal neuralgia, the most specific localized form of trigeminal neuralgia in history of my practice, but it may be dental pathology. So let's have them check you out first before we go too far. So those are some pearls for referring to the dentist. But when and where do you refer patients with trigeminal neuralgia where you don't think there's a dental pathology? I would recommend that if you think they have type 1 pain, because you're an expert in the classification now, and even you might have been before, and you're having sharp, stabbing, electrical, episodic pain, and they respond to Tegretol, then I would refer to the neurosurgeon. You may have started Tegretol already, and that's great, and we can, you know, manage it from there, particularly if a second drug is necessary. If you've done an MRI in the way that I've outlined, perfect, thank you. If not, then we can do that MRI. And we'd only go to a surgical procedure if the patient's really failed medical therapy. And we would go to the right surgical procedure. So sometimes a patient's referred to me for Gamma Knife, but then I uncover I do another MRI, trigeminal protocol, and I uncover major vascular compression, and they're 68 years old. I'm going to refer that patient to my colleague who specializes in MVD, just as I specialize in Gamma Knife, and I'm going to then get them to the right person. Now, type 2 trigeminal neuralgia, so everything other than type 1, I would refer to the neurologist. They'll try or pick up on your trial of Tegretol. If you don't have an MRI, they'll get one. And they'll refer to us ultimately if they fail medical therapy. Remember, even type 2 will respond to procedures such as Gamma Knife, but just not as well, not as high percentage, and not as quickly, but it can still work. And within the Mayfield Clinic, we have 5 fellowship-trained neurosurgeons who specialize in facial pain, who do all the procedures that I mentioned, and we each specialize in one particular procedure. So we're here to help. I do a lot of virtual consults. So I see patients for trigeminal neuralgia at a distance, 5-state area. And I give guidance to nurse practitioners all the time on how to manage the medications. All right. It has been a great pleasure going over this entire review of trigeminal neuralgia. I hope that it's been helpful for you as you see these patients.